introduction on the CMC website. It's marvelous.
But I don't think she's got it.
No, no, it's marvelous. Yeah, we should say it again.
Well, the text has a subtext.
Oh, okay.
You know, kind of in a way an underside story. This is really a story of a. It's really like it's like a mini opera for you, mm-hmm. and with you being the other characters, just non-human, and no aspersions on you, and a woman who feels alienated and is questioning what's going on around her. She's an urban woman. She's a modern urban woman, North American. Specifically American, really. And of course, the first one here, it's a question of her identity. She feels she's lost it. And what? And so then she looks around her. What does she see? She sees computer people. People who are, they talk computer and they even sex computer. They're just new people talk computer. And she giggles at the fact, a light giggle. They sex computer. Where are the words here? When the pressing the bow down on the viola, she says they sex computer. It shows how sexy they are. and then finally they never die. They just go for new parts. So, it's very light on the side, you know. It's kind of. And then she also is aware that the world might come to a at any time. Science is fabulous, and they promise a tremendous hit. The reason for the decrescendo there at the end is she realizes when she says tremendous hit, at first she's impressed. Mm. Be a tremendous hit, you know. But she's saying, be a tremendous hit. You know, because mm-hmm. the hit is going to be...
The realization, right?
The hit is going to be like, you know, she's trying to realize what the hit means. Yeah. That's going to come from silence. Skyscrapers are trees of the city. People are fallen leaves. Kind of, you know, a remark about people in modern age are fallen. And changing color by economy, in other words, materialistic culture. And can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah. And falling down, leaves falling down, and people falling down. And she asks, will someone, I'll buy 100 shares of AT&T, if someone will please communicate, she wants someone to communicate with her. I mean, she feels alone in all of this. With the computer people and the CIA, you know, alienating her and so forth and so on. And so she's looking for communication, and then she hears. That's almost like the birds communicating with her. You know. That little song there, viola, is something that. When I was writing these poems, I was in London, in Barnes Common, in Hammersmith, and there's this blackbird would come to my window and sing that song every day. Just like that. Do-ya, di-ya, 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 same one every day. And I would even say to it, you know, I would talk to it sometimes, you know, and say crazy things like, hey blackbird, you know. Who are you singing to? No one's listening. Of course, I was listening. But I mean, I don't know if the blackbird knew this. But I'm wondering, why does she sing when no one's listening? Again, for alienation point, you know, that Also, I remarked on the way I thought about the music scene in New York at that time, which was very commercial, and I guided by the influence strongly in composition by the Atonal Mafia.
This is the 60s, I thought this was?
Hmm?
In the 60s, specifically?
60s.
In New York, yeah.
Yeah. And so, anyway, so he asked the bird, why do you sing when no one's listening? You're out there on a branch by yourself and no other birds around. And then she answers her own question, because the bird just keeps singing, and that, well, spring is listening. And when she answers that question for herself, because since spring is perennial, that gives her new hope. In other words, that there's the implication here is she was contemplating ending her life. But now she changes her mind with the conversation with the bird and the idea now that spring is listening. And that's when she says, good night, day, and thanks. I'll have you report tomorrow. In general, I'd say your legs are clean, your trees are trim, grass green. Give me a good report tomorrow, and I'll... What? Give me a good report tomorrow, and I'll... What?
Give you the contract next year. Give you the contract?
And I'll give you the contract,
yeah.
Same time
yeah.
next year.
Yeah.
It's just, her way of saying, I'll be here, if you're here,
that's right.
I'll be here. So she decides to live. This is not something you play. You know, you say it straight, but that's what comes, kind of comes through. You know?
Yeah. Lovely, thank you.
Yeah, the less emotional quote expression, you know, the better, I think, because straight tone, skyscrapers or trees in the city, just say it, I mean, just straight ahead, same thing. Baby's Eyes is, in a way, it's almost tacked on, because this is a story, and Baby's, but it works in the same idea of alienation. I just read Martin Luther King's letters from to his wife from prison. And so baby, in this case, doesn't mean babies. It means, hey, baby, you know, I miss you. So that's just a song about, well, in the song, it even says, at the end of it, well, I remember baby's laughter in prison until I'm dead and after. Yeah, we don't know if you ever saw her again, I mean, from the poem. You know. But it's almost as if maybe you had that experience, you know. You, the character in this story. But that's the story of movie.
Great, thank you.